It's a pleasure to know you're still with us on The Breakfast this morning. It's time to take a look at the papers to try and understand what's beyond the headlines. And to help us make sense of it, we have the co-convener of Bring Back Our Girls group, Aisha Yusufu. Thank you very much for joining us, Aisha.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right. So this morning we're starting with stories on the Punch newspapers. The most popular hashtag that has been in across Nigeria and maybe also in parts of the world still is making the news this morning, and that is the NSARS protest. It says, on the Punch, federal government clamps down on NSARS promoters, freezes accounts. CBN places post no debit restriction on pharmacist's account. Lawyer accuses Nigeria Immigration Service of stopping her trip abroad. Also, federal government's panel gets 160 petitions, begins sitting today. Other stories on the Punch. Lekki toll gate camera stopped working at 8 p.m., says MD. DPO charges assaulted Oyo Taylor to court over poor job. And also this morning on the Punch, core members to undergo new COVID-19 tests before orientation, says the NCDC. The federal government seeks fresh $1.2 billion loan from Brazil. Also on the Punch this morning, again, federal government and NASU meets today over controversial payment platform. And Trump and Biden upbeat as U.S. voters express confidence in the process. Reps stop TCN's 2021 projects. A firm blames higher authorities. These are the major ones that we will be taking this morning. Of course, the Senate queries lie on 19 million naira travel expenses during lockdown. Aisha Yusufu, over to you.
Thank you so much. I think I'm going to start with the clamp down on NSAS promoters, as it is said here. It's quite sad that the government is focused on intimidating and harassing citizens who simply came out to make demands that is in a manner that is constitutionally allowed. You expect all of this effort will be against citizens who are coming at the state. Rather, it's against citizens who are peaceful. And we've had, there have been a lot of restriction on accounts of members of the NSARS movement and the protesters. And of course, we saw what happened a few days ago where one of the lawyers, who, what was her crime? She just simply provided free legal services for those who were arrested by the authority. And for that, she has been stopped. Yesterday, there was a tweet from her where she said she went to get her passport, but it still hasn't been given to her. She has already missed the script that she's going to. And there's all across board. There's intimidation. There's this purport list that is going around. If there's any list, like I've said before, I just hope they make me number one on that list and they get to spell my name, especially my surname, correctly the way it is. But this harassment just needs to stop, and government need to understand that they get their power from the people, and it's not the other way around. On the issue of the petition, federal government's panel has sitting. One of the things that NSARS movement, one of their demands is that the governing council of the National Human Rights Commission should be set up, because there's no governing council, and quite a number of people, some lawyers have talked about the fact that the legitimacy of all of these panels where you do not have a governing council. And so that's really something that needs to be set up.
That's actually something I would like to pick your brain on again. What's your understanding of these levels of panel? We have the federal government panel, and then we're having state chapters, states having the panel. How will the collation look? What's your collation of the findings look like, and what's your understanding of it?
Well, for my understanding of it is the fact that the police and the military, they are all under the federal government. And when you talk about putting all of these panels in at the state level, there's a limit to some of the things they can do. We saw what happened with the Lagos State panel. when they tried to go to visit a morgue at a military hospital in Lagos. They were actually denied. They were not allowed to go in. And of course, you know, the state doesn't have powers over the military. And even though some did say that, yeah, the president had said, made mention of this panel, so that gives them legitimacy. But we're talking about Nigeria, where really even institutions don't seem to listen to what the president is saying. I think I heard there was a report of the Rivers State governor who had said that they've done several other panels at state level and nothing really did come out of it. So at the end of the day, when even people are indicted, when the panels come up with their findings, would it really be effective? And you have this federal, so who are the ones to go to the federal level? Who are the ones to go to the state level? Is it the people in Abuja only that are focused on the federal panel? So it's a bit, you know, it's all over the place. And I think all of this would have just been settled if, for example, we had something like a truth and a reconciliation kind of a panel, just like we had the Okuta panel, and, you know, have people come out and trash all of these issues together. That would be much better than what we have right now. But as it is, we are following the process, and we'll continue to monitor and ensure that justice is what is being aimed for.
All right. Quickly also speak on the CCTV cameras that apparently stopped working at 8 p.m.
Yes. Okay. So the CCTV camera, according to the MD, stopped working at 8 p.m. on that day. So, which means that the shootings and everything will be captured, because the shootings actually started, I think, around 6:50 kind of time. So that should be part of it. But there was quite I don't know where there was a statement that was reported the way where the MD was said to said. Oh, the CCTV did not capture the shooting. So I'm like, okay, how do you know the shooting wasn't captured if it's not there? But I think what is most important is transparency and accountability. And right now, it doesn't seem to be there. And the camera should just be brought out. Let the world know the truth. Nigerians do know the truth, but let the world know the truth. And the impunity of some of these things that are happening, it just baffles one's mind that they just seem to play with our intelligence. Even just from there, I would go to the story of where they're talking Senate queries lie on 19 million travel expenses during lockdown. I mean, this is just the impunity that we have. They don't even care to think about our intelligence when some of these things are happening. How can you have traveled when they were supposed to have been locked down and everybody was inside the house? Was it a spiritual kind of traveling that needed money to be used or what it is? We just turned into a joke, and we just have people who just have turned a leadership role into some sort of circus. And we really do need to do something about it as citizens of this country.
All right. Let's see what's on Nigerian Tribune this morning. Interesting headline. One just stood out for me. Let's start with a big one. Nigeria's debt to hit 38.68 trillion naira in 2021. That's on page 6 and 7 of the paper. It has two riders. The first is 873 billion naira released for capital projects. REBS threatened to remove new power projects in 2021 budget proposal. That's also on the front page of the paper showing on your screen right now. We have on the side of it, Egypt to deport NSAS protesters without resident permit. Details on page 2. Or your assembly suspends 13 caretaker chairman, directs secretariat to take over missing genitals. Youths burn down churches, burn down houses, church in Benue. I know some might think this is a bit of a trivial issue to start off with, but I'd like you to speak on this mob violence and this persistent. This situation seems to continue to trail us. We continue to hear stories of individuals saying their genitalia has been stolen at some point. It's no longer functional. This continues over the years, and now it's led to the burning of churches and houses. What's your thinking on that before we go to the other big ones?
Well, it's just, I don't know. It just talks about the kind of people that we are and the kind of things that we focus in. I've always been surprised at this allegation of somebody's capacity to steal, somebody's genitalia, or private parts, or whatever they tend to call it. And most times people just say to you, oh, you know, because you don't believe in this thing, it does happen and all of that. It just shows the kind of, I don't know, the kind of people that we are and the kind of things that we focus on. We focus on this spirituality. We focus on things that will happen in the supernatural. We don't just like looking at facts and evidence. And a lot of times, things that we call witchcraft or one thing or the other are just merely maybe physical symptoms of certain kind of illness or one thing or the other. And so I wonder, the power to steal this genitalia, can we use it in science and technology and actually have something out there? But I think the thing for me, most importantly, apart from even the fact of the missing gen, is this mob action. The way we seem to normalize these things, people will just take the laws into their hands. People will just burn. Sometimes you just see a crowd. They will kill someone at that moment, put tires, set somebody on fire. It's just unbelievable. And the most annoying thing is the fact that these people over the years are never punished. They're never arrested, prosecuted, and then justice is never going. And then it emboldens more people to keep doing it. And so we just have a nation full of a lot of serial killers and also serial arsonists and people who take all of this mob action. I think the state should begin to do something. This is where we need the state to really act. But the main thing is that you will never find police in any of these doing investigation, arresting people and getting people prosecuted. It is when it comes to peaceful protests that they seem to remember and that they seem to know the power that they're supposed to have.
Before you go on to take on, and let me quickly highlight this so you have that as an option as well. COVID-19, 65% of returning international passengers dodge tests. Next 2 weeks critical. That's according to the PTF. We also have all core members to undergo antigen-based test. That's the NCDC speaking. I think that about covers some of the headlines that we have. We know governors are also meeting today to review internal security, defunct SARS looting, among others. That story was sent in from Abuja. All right, over to you now.
Oh, okay. So taking the COVID-19, 65% of returning international passengers dodge tests. I've spoken about this before. I think the handling from the Nigerian government is absolutely shabby. I came back into the country on the 17th of September. And when we got in, first of all, trying to even pay the money and for the tests and everything, it was difficult. The bank, it wouldn't go. I couldn't do that. At the end of the day, I had to leave it. When I came into Nigeria at the airport, I expected that I was going to use my card to pay, but there was nobody who we could pay to. And at the end, they said, "Oh, okay, yeah, we could all go." There were some people who came in who were able to do their own payment. It went through. So at that moment, and one of the things that they had said was that they were going to collect people's passports, and no passport was ever collected. We just left. As I'm here now, I think from 17 to today, it's over a month that I've been back in the country. I've never gotten a call from anyone to say, "Oh, have you? Did you do your test?" or a mail. And all of these details were collected from us: our emails, our house addresses, our phone numbers. But nothing. So I did my quarantine, 2 weeks quarantine, and then I took myself out. I went to go and do the test, and the test came out. I think I went for the test, was it 7 days after? And then I stayed the remaining 7 days in. Nobody called me, or there was no mail, there was no text, there was nothing from anyone. And for me, oh my goodness, why do we always do this in Nigeria? And I know there are a lot of people that will not comply with anything. I mean, there's no enforcement. And so I think the biggest problem is coming from the government agencies themselves in the way that they have handled this. And they aren't doing what they're supposed to do. So, and you know, the Nigerian thing, most people just feel that, oh, all of these things don't matter. I saw someone on Twitter who was saying, I just came back into the country and I'm out. And I think that had to do with, I think, one of the DJ Copy. I think that's her name. And she was saying that, oh, she had come back. She couldn't join the NSAS protest because she was observing her quarantine. And then another Twitter user says to her, oh, no, I too came back from the country and I'm out there protesting. And I said, no, you need to be on quarantine. It's 2 weeks. And I know a lot of people who kept saying to me, oh, no, these 2 weeks is not it. You can't. I said, no, because for me, basically, it's about I hold myself to higher standards. That I hold any other person. That's one of the reasons why I'm able to look anybody in the eye and make demands on them the way I should. But I think that the government handling of this, it's totally shabby.
All right. I would like you to, before we move to The Guardian, we have a few minutes left, but I want you to quickly also speak on the 38.6 trillion naira debt that we're looking at in 2021.
Well, the thing is that the unborn generation to Nigeria, before they are even brought in here, they already have debts on their head that they're going to keep managing and seeing how they're going to pay. And the main important thing, it's not even about the fact, I see people will tell you that, oh, U.S. has so. It's not about the debt, it's about what it has been used for. If you borrow money in such a way to put in project that at the end of the day will lead to development, will lead to revenue generation, that's a different thing. But when you borrow this money and we don't see anything on ground and it seems to find its way most times to the pocket of individuals. People are enriching themselves. The state is becoming poorer and poorer. It's absolutely pathetic. And most especially beyond this debt, the debt servicing, we are borrowing money to service debt. I don't even know how we still don't get that part. The more we have to borrow more to be able to pay the interest, not even the capital itself, not the principal itself, but the interest. And yet our governance, the cost of governance is still extremely high. We're not doing anything to reduce it.
Still
you see more and more projects that are unnecessary in the budget.
Okay,
our agencies are buying cars.
We
drive the streets of Abuja. The flashiest cars you see, the latest Prado jeeps that you see, it's from government agencies.
Hold on.
We have
about 3 minutes. I want us to quickly look at The Guardian. We probably would only have time to speak on one of the stories in The Guardian. So let's quickly move over there. And of course, you can see the lead one there is talking about Nigerians and their reactions to the North's stand on NSAS and social media bill. That's about the only story we might have time to speak on. So quickly just address that so we can say goodbye this morning.
The northern governors have made their position clear that they have issues. They do not like peaceful protesters are coming out to make demands, but they have no problem with insurgency, people protesting through violent insurgency, through banditry, through all the insecurity that is happening. They prefer that kind of showing displeasure at the state than the one that has to do with citizens coming out to peacefully protest. You see, their meeting, they were not concerned about the insecurity. They were only concerned about the answer. And for me, the brazenness of putting out a communique and actually praising their religious and traditional leaders for using ethnic sentiments and religious sentiments to whip up sentiments and divide these states a lot. And I think, personally, I think it is time we sit down and have the Nigerian conversation. Do we want to be a country together or not? And it is not for the North to tell us about the indivisibility of this nation. It's for Nigeria. What is sacrosanct is good governance, accountability, and transparency, and not just the term one Nigeria. If it's not working, it's not working. And let's have a conversation and see whether everybody will find its way so that everyone can do what they want to do, how they want to do it on their own terms, not on the terms of everybody else.
All right. Nicely put. You want to chip in anything?
Thank you very much, Aisha, for your thoughts, as always, on The Breakfast this morning.
Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure always. Something she mentioned about the NSAS protest, and that thing has been bugging me, really. Most of the reports are saying the CCTV camera, you know, during The Breakfast at some point, I did say that, you know, one way to engender, you know, transparency is for them to just release that CCTV tape. Now we're hearing that most people are reporting 8 p.m. I watched the video of the chairman, the MD, and what he said was around 8 p.m. So meaning that there is a possibility that the tip could have ended at 7 o'clock. There's a possibility it could have ended at about 2 minutes after seven.
So a
chunk of the evidence might be lost if we don't have that tape.
So one of the things that I also saw was, you know, people weren't comfortable with the questioning of the MD. What further questions were asked after he said, or after he made that statement? The information that also has been on social media also shows that the shootings and whatever happened on the 20th started around 6:25, 6:30, 6:40 about then. So there's still a chunk of time between that and 8 p.m.
Sure.
So are we going to see that? If we say that, you stop recording sometime around 8 p.m., why did it stop recording? Where is, you know, the bit
that
recorded?
I think he explained that a bit. The reason is that there was a technical issue. They don't supply lights to the place. I'm not going to hold forth from them, but there are so many issues around that. Okay. Let's see what happens.
So what about between 6 p.m. and when eventually it stopped? But if you say around 8 p.m., I'm maximum going to give you 7:45 to 8:15.
Okay. A quick thought before we wrap up. Our director is whispering in our ears to wrap things up quickly. I just want to, concur a bit to what she said about mob violence.
Yeah.
You know, we just hear something, we just jump to action, killing our fellow human being. I don't even know how people are able to raise an object to hit your fellow human being because you're angry without evidence.
So because, and this is the way that I see it. So I think that the Nigerian has been abused and has been used to a level of abuse and violence for so long that they also have learned that to be normal. And that's why you can see a mob kill a person on the street that people just walk by. It's not justification.
There has to be some level of restraint. We have to begin to learn that.
You would expect that, but that's the reason we always see these things and we walk by. These things are now normal for a lot of people.
It may never be normal for us.
Where also is our security agencies when they see mob action?
Hello, hope you enjoyed the news. Please do subscribe to our YouTube channel and don't forget to hit the notification button so you get notified about fresh news updates.